You're right, and that's exactly what I'm going to say. I'm not going to say there's no debate, but I'm also supposed to speak for about 10 minutes. We have 20 minutes left now. So if you don't want to hear, I won't say, and straight go to the debate, in which case you won't get to hear about a very small country called India. Otherwise, we can go and straight go to the debate, or I've already cut my speech in half, so yeah. But I leave it to you. It's your call. Okay, sure. Thanks. So let me talk about Sanal, who was supposed to have been here, and his story needs to be heard, because we've spoken a lot about Islam, but not enough about Hinduism and Christianity. And Sanal is a man of no faith from India, who runs the Indian Rationalist Association. And he's the president of that. His mission in life is to expose fraud being perpetrated in the name of miracles. Some years ago, he challenged a Hindu seer who said that he could kill anybody by saying a mantra. So Sanal said, fine, let's do it on television. And the television station decided to show it live. And it went on, and it went on, and it went on. It took a couple of hours, after which the seer's voice was rasping and restless, and Sanal was chortling and giggling. But his real challenge came later, when there was a church in Bombay, where I was born, where water was emerging from the toe of Christ's cross. Tens of thousands of Catholics and others came to pay homage, and some even drank the water. Sanal decided to investigate with a friend who was a scientist, and they found that there was moisture on the wall on which the statue was mounted, and the water came from an overflowing drain, which was fed by a pipe from a toilet nearby. Now, this is the nice part, but there's a sad part to it. The so-called Catholic Secular Forum, I like the name, Catholic Secular Forum, sued him under Section 295A of the Indian Penal Code, and he would have been jailed before the charges were investigated. He feared for his safety, so he left early on a speaking tour to Europe, came to Finland, got an asylum. The cases still remain. The water has stopped dripping, by the way. But here's a really sad part, that the man who wanted to defend him, a man called Narendra Dabholkar of the Blind Faith Elimination Society of Bombay, he was murdered. This modern industry of taking offense with blasphemy has begun, and India should rightfully claim its place on it, a lot with the novel Satanic Verses. And India was, of course, the first country not to ban the novel. I mean, India always finds weird ways of framing rules so that they get the desired effect, but it looks very legal. It banned the import of the novel, and it made sure that no one would publish it within the country, because if they did, then there would be these lawsuits. I was a young reporter at that time, and I met many Muslim leaders who were genuinely hurt and angry. They used the word blasphemy, which is very unusual because India doesn't have blasphemy laws to start with. And as expected, none of them had read the book. Several actually told me that I don't have to read that filth. Not only did they fundamentally misunderstand Rushdie's exceptional gift of imagining an alternative universe, they also failed to grasp its central idea. And what was that idea? That a poet's work is to name the unnameable, to point at frauds, to take sides, to start arguments, to stop the world from going to sleep. But India is secular, and yet therefore state is an equal opportunity state, so it bows to every religion. Since India has kowtowed to Christians, of course, several states have banned the screening of the film Da Vinci Code because Christians claimed offense to that film. The left doesn't want to be left far behind. Taslima, if she's in the room, her memoir, Dvikhandito, was banned in 2003 by the left front government in West Bengal. This morning, the Indian police stopped the distribution of a magazine that provides an alternate reading of Hindu mythology in which caste discrimination is frowned upon because it offended upper caste students at a university. They were offended that they were called castists, so they wanted the magazine banned. Earlier this year, Penguin's Indian arm decided to pulp the remaining copies of Wendy Doniger's inquiry into Hinduism because it felt no longer able to defend a case filed against it by a Hindu nationalist group. A friend of mine who runs a think tank called Nitin Pai, he calls it competitive intolerance. If Muslims can get Salman Rushdie banned, if Christians can get Nikos Kazantzakis' Six Sacred Wound of Christ banned, why should the Hindus feel left out? And therefore, Hindus have made an exile out of India's greatest painter, Maqbool Fida Hussain, who lived and died in the end in London. At the age of 98, he passed away. One of the finest Indian painters, and his art too in London was attacked by Hindu nationalists. So, in fact, the exhibition had to be closed early. Indian constitution has lots of caveats which restrict freedom of expression, which includes reasonable restrictions, which is a grab bag of concerns about sovereignty, integrity, security of state, friendly relations with foreign nations, public order, decency, morality, contempt of court, defamation, incitement of an offense. Section 295A and 153A go further, allowing anybody to file a suit against anybody to stop them from saying something that they disagree with. Just looking next door to India in Pakistan, Parvez Bhutboy told us a lot of stories about Ahmadis, but I just wanted to point out that defamation, in particular blasphemy laws, are extremely severe in Pakistan. In India, books get banned. In Pakistan, people who defend those who might be facing blasphemy charges die. Salman Taseer was a governor of Punjab who wanted to reform Pakistan's blasphemy law, called for its reform, requesting the pardon for Asya Bibi, a poor Christian woman in rural Pakistan who was facing the death penalty. Serious questions were raised about the fairness of the trial, the proportionality of the punishment, and most cases always tended to, as evidence has shown, target the minorities and the poor. But the laws do go back to colonial times. Salman Taseer actually was murdered for saying this, and the lawyer who did the committed the murder actually was showered with rose petals by lawyers when he was brought to the trial. Indeed. And there is another story similar to that, unfortunately, of Rashid Rehman, a lawyer who was murdered because he was defending Junaid Hafiz, a very young lecturer who is in jail on blasphemy charges. The Bar Association actually passed a resolution saying nobody should defend his type of blasphemy cases. It was indeed a chronicle of a death foretold. Days before his killing, Rehman had been threatened by other lawyers, if you take up this case, your life is in danger. And he told the BBC philosophically that I'm stepping into the jaws of death. If those who understand Urdu here would know, he said, "Maut ke muh mein ja raha hoon," is what he said. Taseer's assassin, as I said, was his bodyguard. Shahbaz Bhatti, the Minister of Minority Affairs, he was also murdered. Now, Pakistan's founding vision was much more liberal. It wanted a state which was not discriminating against minorities, and its objective resolution in 1949 actually called for freely to profess all religions. In 1973, it was Zulfikar Ali Bhutto who dropped the word freely, and he passed laws against Ahmadiyyas. That also happened in that time. And after that, Ziaul Haq came, who made the laws much stronger until 1982. Only 9 blasphemy prosecutions were launched in Pakistan. Since then, more than 1,000 individuals have been persecuted, prosecuted, harassed, or murdered. So that's the situation that you find in Pakistan. There is a global move now, which I wanted to bring as a last point, that the Organization of Islamic Conference wants to canonize or make the whole defamation and blasphemy argument sacrosanct by outlawing religious defamation internationally. The resolutions have been tabled at the UN General Assembly and at the Human Rights Council in an attempt to capitalize on the concerns of Islamophobia following the 2001 attacks in the US on one hand and the Danish cartoons on the other. Non-binding resolutions have been passed. In Haroon and the Sea of Stories, Rushdie wrote, "All these arguments and debates, all that openness has created powerful bonds of fellowship between them. The chupwalas, that is those who are silent, turn out to be a disunited rebel, suspicious and distrustful of one another. The land of gup, that is a land of talk, is bathed in endless sunshine, while over at chup, it is always the middle of the night." Our discourse is getting narrower, ladies and gentlemen. Blasphemy laws are prevailing, and if they do, we will move to the land of gup and not the land, move from the land of gup to the land of chup. Men, mostly men, but often women too, who have read or heard about only one book, or few books, who claim to know the truth, who believe others must obey and comply, are increasingly silencing other ideas. It is entirely for us to challenge that and keep talking, arguing, disagreeing, and expressing. I began with a quote from the Satanic Verses. Let me end with another one. What kind of an idea are you? Are you the kind that compromises, does deals, accommodates itself to society, aims to find a niche to survive? Or are you the cussed, bloody-minded, ramrod-backed type of a damn fool notion that would rather break than sway in the breeze? The kind that will almost certainly, 99 times of 100, be smashed to bits. But the 100th time, it will change the world. Thank you.